At Soulcares, we develop innovative soil testing technology. We use sensor technology, which is really an innovation in soil testing, and it allows for in-field, very fast testing of your soil. So within minutes, a farmer knows the soil fertility status and receives a recommendation on the spot what inputs to use to really have a fertile soil and get the yields for the crop that he's cropping. We develop the technology, but we sell our technology to service provider who in their turn offer the services to the farmers. So we link to organizations working with smallholder farmers. These can be cooperatives, NGOs, input providers, agro dealer, private extension, governments, etc. They bring the service to the farmer. So and so that's how we reach the smallholder farmer. Well, MercyCorps introduced it to some of our current service providers, including iProcure, and we are partner of DigiFarm. So MercyCorps has been very supportive to us. This is an innovation. It's new, and it's new worldwide. And I'm quite proud to say that the first device was actually distributed here in Kenya. So it's really an innovation that started here. But with all new innovations, adoption goes slow. Only 1 to 2% of the population is an early adopter, while the remainder, the vast majority, is what is called a follower. So they will wait for the results for others to come. It's a seasonality issue. So you only test your soil at the beginning of the season. So it takes time to reach scale. And that's our main challenge at this moment.
So I'm Mike Tweed. I'm a senior manager based here in Nairobi for Delberg Advisors. We are a platform of different businesses focused on helping people achieve their fullest potential. We've been partners with MercyCorps AgriFin for the last 4 years. We're strategy partners working on the toughest problems that they're tackling with. So whatever the next thing comes up, the next hurdle to overcome to support smallholder farmers, that's what we like to dive into. I think the key is to try and make sure that every time we're keeping the smallholder farmer at the focus, so that whatever platform we're building, whatever problem we're trying to solve, it's with the aim of increasing their income and their dignity and livelihoods. So for us as Delberg, we've got 11 offices across Africa and 21 across the globe. And because we've got such an Africa-focused presence, we're in each office, in each region, tackling issues to do with agriculture, to do with smallholders, and digital finance. And it's most exciting when we see those come together and allow those to increase incomes for smallholder farmers. By tackling the deep-rooted problems for the smallholder farmer, whether that's access to credit or market access or increased learning or something else associated with that, by us as Delberg working with AgriFin to really understand what's going on with the farmers, we can address the problems underlying, understand their points of view, their perspectives, rather than delivering solutions that might be just good on the surface but don't address the deep-seated problems.
I'm personally thrilled to attend the event today for a couple of reasons. At MercyCorps, we're really focused on trying to help entrepreneurs and a wide range of organizations take innovative solutions to the world's toughest challenges to scale. And I think today's event is absolutely critical in a couple of ways. One is that we know when we're tackling some of the world's toughest challenges, for example, helping smallholder farmers prosper, that it takes, you know, we can't go it alone. It takes so many partners to do that. So today we're having the opportunity to learn from one another and map some of the courses forward as to how we can scale to reach even more smallholder farmers in the future.
But we've been able to hit a high number of users through different user acquisition channels. For example, we have radio, we reach farmers and rural people, and we use radios that cover a range network and locations in country and also in Tanzania and Uganda to acquire users through radio programs. And also, we have boots on the ground where we have brand ambassadors that have faith and trust in WeFarm, go out to the villages and recruit farmers to be onboarded. So for now, WeFarm is free for the farmers. We don't charge. The SMS is zero rated, and that cost, WeFarm absorbs it. But essentially, we're a big data company. We have a lot of conversations that are organically generated by the farmers, and we use that data to do data analysis and create insights for organizations that are playing in the industry. And we are able to tell, for example, farmers who are buying or have the need to buy certain farming inputs, where they are, how much they need and all that. So we are a major player in the industry holistically, connecting the threads and the dots using organically generated data. So we monetize the data itself.
AgriFin is all about helping technology innovation meet smallholder farmers, and working in Kenya is a dream. Kenya is a hub of Africa in terms of technology innovation. We've been here for 4 years. We're working with over 50 partners, and we're seeing growth beyond our expectations. So we hope to reach 1 million farmers in 6 years, and we're reaching almost 1.4 million already in 4 years. Looking forward to a lot more. For smallholder farmers, they've been farming the same way for a long time. Learning on a cell phone, learning on digital channels can be a bit new. So building trust is really important. Making sure that the language works, that the information fits their needs is a big challenge. And we're learning and we're growing, but more and more farmers are starting to use it, and we're seeing benefits for the farmers. I think that human-centered design, spending time with the farmers, listening to what they need, and focusing on not just all farmers, but women farmers and young farmers have different problems from male farmers, and different dreams and different expectations and different challenges. So I think we need to spend more time really talking to farmers and design for their needs.
ATA, over the past 5 years, has been delivering a number of different projects that are based on improving the livelihoods of smallholder farmers. Many of these projects have a digital component and a technology component, and they've reached a large scale, some going as far as reaching 6 million farmers. However, many of these platforms that we're using at the moment are not as coordinated as they could be, and the delivery of services could expand even broader and deeper than they are at the moment. So the integration of the digital platforms, as well as the delivery of additional services, is something that we hope we'll be able to address through the partnership with AgriFin. At the moment, we are still learning from what AgriFin has been doing in Kenya and some of these other countries, and its entry in Ethiopia, funded by the Gates Foundation, is imminent, but it has not started yet. So what we can say that we have learned from what AgriFin has done in other countries is the bundling of these digital services in financial institutions, something that Ethiopia is still at the preliminary stages of doing. And the second is the leveraging of private sector partners to deliver many of these services. In Ethiopia, the public sector seems to be very dominant when it comes to the engagement directly with farmers, as well as with the introduction of innovations. What we've seen in the AgriFin program in other countries is that private sector is playing a very large role, and something that we would like to see emerge more distinctively in Ethiopia.
If you look at the discourse around, people fear technology and say technology is going to eliminate jobs and whatever. I think when you bring such discourse to the people, it lessens that fear and allows technology to be used in some of the special areas. For example, there are things that we are able to do today which we would never have done before. Technology is enabling us to do that. For years, our supply chains were broken. We are beginning to see companies that have developed good supply chains and have enabled farmers to benefit from those supply chains. A farmer is the most exploited person. Most of them receive almost less than 25% of the value of what they produce. If we can continue with this discourse, we could disrupt the farmer. And that is the area that we need to disrupt. Of course, I don't like being confined to the small farmer. The best probably is to get the farmers to consolidate land, and then we have large-scale farmers, which is what we call agribusiness. It would not happen because we have already messed our farms into smaller pieces, so we need to disrupt them at that space.
AgriFin is a four-year, to date has been going on for 4 years. It's a six-year program funded by the MasterCard Foundation, but it's actually an extension of an existing program that was called AgriFin Mobile. And AgriFin Mobile was a global program, but focused on three programs, one in Asia, one in Africa, and actually two in Asia. And as a result of the learning from that program, we developed AgriFin Accelerate, which is a much more focused program in terms of helping to facilitate the fintech sector, so the financial services and technology sector, work together with the agricultural sector. And that's a highly concentrated effort to really bring together partnerships, adapt technology to the challenges that smallholder farmers face, and to accelerate growth and productivity and welfare for smallholder farmers in East and Southern Africa. We've been working principally in three markets in East and Southern Africa, as I mentioned, Kenya, Tanzania, and Zambia. And each of those markets was selected because each is at a different stage in terms of development and the technology ecosystem. Of course, Kenya is really the hub of that activity in East Africa and really Africa as a whole. So here we have a tremendous set of partners and opportunities and a lot of experimentation within the sector that we learn from, we harness, we bring together, we apply in different ways. Whereas in Tanzania, really that's very much developing, and while there's a lot of activity and excitement in the sector as a whole, institutionally and in terms of the depth of those types of startups and more traditional actors in the sector, the banks, the mobile network operators, haven't quite adopted digital technology in quite the same way. And Zambia is actually very much a nascent market, even though it's very developed in terms of infrastructure and very integrated around more traditional banking systems. They haven't had the kind of adoption for instance, mobile money and other products like that that East Africa has had. So we really structured the program to see and look at the differences, how each tier of these markets really behaves when you start to drive partnerships around between ag tech and fintech. And the results of that have been very promising in some markets. And like any startup, there's always failures, but there's always real advances as well. The big win thus far, and I'm always hesitant to say that because you never know what happens day to day, but what's worked very well has been a partnership with Safaricom here in Kenya. And that's a broader partnership actually with Vodafone regionally. But Safaricom and Vodafone together came together around a product called DigiFarm. And the product existed prior to AgriFin Accelerate entering into the conversation. But it was somewhat stymied because, you know, really what was lacking was getting the voice of the smallholder farmer really into the conversation. And what we did with them, and which I think was a starting point for any type of product development, is going back to the consumer, to who you're trying to reach, and build ways in which they can participate in the product development. So we use a technique called human-centered design, which takes design elements as well as participatory methods in order to really understand the needs, the pain points, the product characteristics, all of those things that make a product work, and injecting them into a storytelling narrative that really resonates with all the different actors that make a product work, from the banking partners to the telco partners to the facilitators on the ground and so on. And that process really brought home how DigiFarm could work as a product that a farmer could use individually, but also that partners, organizations that take on this product as the tool to bring farmers on board to their financing scheme would work for them. So DigiFarm is effectively a platform of three essential products. First is an interactive learning product. The second is an input supply, an agricultural input supply distribution scheme. And the third is a loan product, an instant loan product, almost like Mshwari for farmers. And each of these was introduced in a staged manner based on what the priorities of farmers were. And at the end of the day, as we've seen through lots of different attempts to do this, is that farmers tend to, that while they value information, they want a conversational exchange of information, they're very reluctant to pay for information because it's the the return for them, the payoff for that, is really very disconnected, right? So you get information about weather, but then the weather event happens later, or the result of that happens long after. And you're not going to pay for something that might have a future benefit. And the same thing with input supply. It's terrific to have a supplier very close to you with a product that's, you know, a good value and good quality, and that's of great importance to the farmer. But there's lots of agrivets and lots of supply options, or somebody coming into the village that offers supply. So it's really about the relationship that you build and the human touch that goes along with it. But we did learn a very important lesson from that initial stage, is that we thought that farmers wanted, first thing they wanted was credit, but actually what farmers told us is that they wanted good quality inputs. They wanted something they could rely on. And then the challenge was, how do you build the supply chain to really reach them? This meant working across three different partners, which is always a very difficult challenge. The information source has been a group called Arifu, a company called Arifu, and they do an interactive chatbot that allows farmers to engage in training and get information about weather inputs and so on. The input supply is a company called iProcure, and iProcure has set up depots across the country and expanded that, and it's a high quality, just-in-time supply chain, so that the farmer can go to an iProcure depot and get the products they need and be assured that it's a quality product, it'll be there when needed, and have a very fair price at that, for that. And then finally, the credit product was linked to both, and that came in as the last element under DigiFarm, last meaning the third, and we anticipate there'll be more product bundles underneath the platform. And that that came a bit later, because without the information and without an assured supply chain, that then there would be less use for a credit product. So the credit product is linked directly to the input supply. We're getting very honest feedback from them, which is what we really want. The use rate has been, the adoption rate of the product has been quite high. About a million farmers have registered for DigiFarm. Active use can be anywhere, depending on whether it's a digital finance product, it'd be about 10% of those farmers. But in the information and supply products could be upwards between 30 to 60% usage rate. So from a mass market product that we're seeing, that's highly tailored towards rural Kenyan farmers, that's actually a pretty good start, and we're very encouraged. And it also means that our partners come together and say, oh, well, this is a serious commercial product, not just a social product, and can get behind that. And that's been a huge boost to getting to, you know, a future phase of the program. This year's early annual learning event was really fantastic. One, because we went purely digital. We say we're a digital company, or a digital accelerator, and we put an app together for the conference that people use. They were active on it, so we got lots of great feedback. We also got about 100 more delegates than we even anticipated. So we're pretty much at our max, and which means that, you know, we've kind of reached a level of excitement and of interest where we really want to be. So we've seen this event really grow. But the most important thing is that we had key actors from the region, from the country, who just dug deep into these conversations and really had a chance to both network, but also debate the issues and the challenges that they face, and look for solutions around that. We don't want this just to be a networking gathering, but it's really a technical meeting. And as one of the participants said to me after the event last evening, was that we didn't try to reach the lowest common denominator there. We actually met people where they were. They wanted to have highly technical and in-depth conversations, and we didn't back off of that. So for me, that was very gratifying to see that kind of feedback.